Good evening. So, of course, there are many terms in the title that demand explanation. In particular, so what is an art? It's Knut said. So, or what is a science? Really, the question that people have asked me is why is it not the science of correct by construction programming? Are there aren't well studied example principles there? So, in some sense, the point is if we knew it well enough. So that you write a computer program to write all other program, then it would be a science. Given a problem statement, the program will apply the principles and generate the resulting program. And then of course, we would all be out of business. So thankfully, it's still an art. But more importantly, science tells you the principles. If you do this, this will happen. Science gives you a deterministic answer. In any situation, you make a difference, what will be the resulting state? But what intervention to make? That is an art. You have many choices at any point, each of which you understand scientifically well enough. But which particular choice to make, which particular series of interventions to take, that is an art. Of course, in that sense, the practice of all science are an art. Okay? So now the question is, what do we mean by correctness? Of course, the obvious meaning is, does the program do what the user intended it to do? But how do you become sure that what the user intended it to do? Or in some sense, a lot of errors happen because people think the program is doing something or is supposed to do something when it's doing something slightly different. So ideally, what we call is that you need a problem statement, a formal problem statement called a specification. That is, ideally, if possible, a mathematical unambiguous statement. Of course, if that's not available, then you try to make it as precise as possible. Okay? So, given this, what is the traditional approaches for ensuring correctness? Of course, the most popular one that probably all of us employ is testing. We write a program, we run various test cases. So, here in some sense, the specification is the set of test cases. The program is correct if it gives the expected answer on all the test cases. Of course, the problem is that you can only write finite number of test cases and there's a risk of missing out some always. So, if you are more scientifically minded, you may employ verification, what's called formal verification. You write the code, then you mathematically prove that the program does what it is supposed to do. So, the only issue is verification happens after you have finished writing the code. So, if the program, if you fails to verify, then you have to go back and change the program. So, the act of verification, in some sense, the correctness criteria came after the program was written. Whereas, in correct by construction programming, the correctness arguments come before you write the program. You say, if I need this and for this, it's like by applying scientific principle, I know that if I do this assignment, it will change the state in this way, which is what I need. So, you give the correctness argument, or correctness argument guide the act of writing the program, so that by the time you finish writing the program, it is correct by construction. So, I will give a very quick example. So, right now what I will do is just introduce this concept of correct by construction at a very high level. Don't worry if you don't understand the details because I am going to come back to this and cover it in lot more detail in the latter half of the talk. So, imagine there is this famous maximum segment sum problem which essentially says that there is a given, there is an array R. So, you can assume any subsegment of R, consider the sum of them and you find the maximum among them. Right? So, that is the problem. So, a formal problem statement is something like this. Suppose you assume nothing, there is no what's called a precondition, S is the unknown program, and then R is the post condition. R is the condition R given here that the variable R contains the maximum of the segments of the sum. Okay? So, now there are many choices available to you. You can divide the array in two halves, do some calculation, merge it. You can scan the array from left to right to left, or whatever you wish. So, in a correct by construction style, essentially you employ some principle. So, for example, suppose you decide I am going to scan the array from left to right. Okay. So, question is, so if you are going to scan the array from left to right, then of course, your program will terminate when you have finished looking at the array. And at that point, you say that, well, why does the program achieve the desired condition? So, to ensure that at this point, when this loop terminates, the program achieves the desired condition, you must have something else called a loop invariant true. So this loop invariant and this termination condition together will give you the post condition. Of course, the point is every time you evaluate this, you don't know whether this condition is true or false. Therefore, this P0 must be true, this some other condition must be true all the time, every time you come here, so that the two together give you the post condition. In this particular case, coming up with P0 was very simple. In this expression, which is your desired post condition, you simply replace capital N by small n, and then, and when the small n becomes equal to capital N, by definition, you get your post condition. So this is what we mean by correct by construction. This loop is this program is correct provided you can write the loop body S0, which maintains the loop invariant P0. Right? So S0 should be such that whenever you start with P0 and this guard, you should end with the P0 true. So again, this is a very quick 1-2 minute introduction. So now, what do you know about S0? Really nothing else except that I am going to go left to right. So at some point I am going to increment n to n plus 1. That's the only thing that is known. Sorry, this mouse, is there a pointer or something? This mouse, my keypad is not. I can't see the mouse. Okay. So n is n plus 1. Okay, so let's not worry about, essentially what now says the scientific principles will tell you that something, what must be true before this. So it's something similar to P0 but a slightly different formula. So you have filled a part of the body and then you have derived new conditions that must be true for this remaining program fragment. Okay. Now if you look at, now again by applying the principles of correct by construction programming, you can discover that the R must change if n is to go to n plus 1. Okay. And then by doing some calculation that we are not getting into now, and I will come back to this later, we have further filled this up, we calculate that R must be same as R max S, where S is to satisfy certain property given here. Okay. And then so on, then we similarly we do something for S. And so at this point our program is complete. And this program, if we didn't make any error in doing this calculation, then this program is correct by construction. So the key point here is that all stages we had a correct by construction program, the program may have had holes. If those holes could be filled, if the holes had a certain, if the holes could be filled such that they have certain desired property, then the whole program is correct by construction. And so we were guided by formula manipulation. And essentially whenever we had an intuition that maybe I will increment n, maybe I will introduce a loop, maybe I will do something else, we explore logical consequences of that. That if I want to do this, what else must be true so that the whole program is correct. That's the basic philosophy of correct by construction, and we'll cover this example in lot more detail but later on. But just before that, a brief talk I outline. So I will talk about some of the preliminaries, and then I will cover two examples in detail, the binary search and this maximum segment sum. And finally, I will talk about a system that my PhD student Deepak has built to assist with this process. Okay, so first I said we have to specify what the program is supposed to do. So that's what we call is a quantifier notation. Essentially this is a familiar sigma for sum, except that we just write it in three parts. There's an operator, there's a set of dummies, then we said for the dummies which satisfy certain range, there's some term on which we apply the operator. So for example, for all the I between 0 and n, sum up the terms of A of I. Or in this case, we are saying that the array is sorted. So for all ij, there should be j here, ai is less than equal to aj. And similarly, the max is again an operator. So this is the maximum segment sum problem we just discussed, that this is the maximum of the sum of the segments of A. So this is a notation we will use for specifying the conditions. So the next is now the specification of program. When we say a program is correct, it means it's a triple QSR, which says program S, when started in a state satisfying Q, will terminate, and it will terminate with a state satisfying R. So this is what we really mean by program correctness. That if this is a valid, this is the specification of a program, this is called, Q is called a precondition, R is called a postcondition. So for example, suppose exponentiation is an unknown program, if b is a non-negative integer, then the program is supposed to compute a to the power b, where we have not, a is an integer, but we have not put any constraint on it. Or this is the specification for maximum segment sum. If n is a non-negative integer, then the program must compute this maximum sum in the variable r.
So this is the first thing.
Second is the notion of weakest precondition. So given any such triple, given any program and a desired postcondition r, you can ask what must be true before x is executed such that r is true. So it is the weakest such condition. That means, of course, many more things can be true at this point, but this must necessarily be true. So the example being here, so take this example. We decrement x, and then we assert that x is still non-negative. Of course, this is a valid specification. If we started this program in a state where x was greater than y, y was greater than 10, so doing this, we know that x is still going to remain positive. So this is a valid specification for this program. But the weakest condition for this is simply that x be greater than or equal to 1 before this assignment statement is executed. So that's the weakest precondition. So there's this notion of weakest precondition for assignment, which in some sense is straightforward. If you are going to assign expression e to variable x, and you want the condition r to be true afterwards, then before doing this assignment, what must be true? Well, in expression r, replace occurrences of x with e. So this must be true before doing the assignment, so that after the assignment, r is true. This is called the weakest precondition of assignment. And there's a simple example here. We wanted x greater than or equal to 0. So here we replace x with x minus 1. So the weakest precondition is x minus 1 is greater than or equal to 0, which is, of course, same as x greater than or equal to 1 here. So note the assignment statement is the only statement that changes a program state, right? Everything else is conditional. So only time you're making changing the value of a variable is via an assignment. So this apparently simple concept is a fundamental concept in reasoning about programs. So having just covered this, now we'll just talk about the binary search example. So I've chosen this example because all of you, of course, must have written binary search. So, and of course, it's very easy to get it wrong also. But moreover, in many different situations, you can adapt binary search. The search is a common problem, and a lot of times you would like to apply a variant of the binary search in a complex situation. So let's just see and make sure that we always get binary search right. There is this problem with these pointers crossing over, getting it an infinite loop and other things. So first thing is we have to come up with a post condition for the, what is the specification for the problem? It's a search problem. So we want, given an array A, we want an index variable x such that A of x is the value we are looking for. But of course, what happens if the value v does not occur in an array? What is the program supposed to do that? So we can simplify we can change the spec to say, if there exists such a value, then x must give us that value. And if value v does not occur in an array, then x can be anything. But of course, that is not what we typically want in a binary search. Even if a value does not occur, we want the nearest value. So we would like to replace this expression with this specification. Okay. So note that, either if x occurs, if value v occurs, then we are going to get it from this condition. Otherwise, we are going to get that point where the array is jumping over v. So a of x is less than or equal to v, and a of x plus 1 is greater than v. Okay. So already, I would like to state that the art in the title, that coming up with this specification for binary search, is already an example of an art. We could have started from here also. This is a spec, or there are many different specification of the binary search possible. So what essentially, there are many different paths, and which path you choose is up to you. But furthermore, now remember, how are we going to go about this? So you already have an informal idea in your mind. You will start from the two ends of the array, and you want to zoom in. So somehow you have to bring in these two ends of the array into the picture, or these two ends of the interval. So again, we would like to rewrite this expression such that we can bring in two variables that represent the two end of the interval. Basically, this is at the end of the program, this is what happened. But what happens at the beginning, right? So we rewrite this. So yes.
Just to split, you could have
Yes, so good point. I'm just coming back to it. So if that was the case, our correct by construction process must discover it somewhere, right? That what if V doesn't occur in the array, right? So that is a point. So we will just come back to that. Okay. So we introduce this by replacing this expression x plus 1 with a variable V, y, and then saying this is our desired post condition. Okay. Obviously, this assumes that the element V occurs in the array, and somewhere in our derivation we must confront that phase, fact. Okay. So we rewrite this. Once you rewrite this in this form, I would say the problem is practically solved. After this, it's reasonably straightforward. By straightforward, I mean there are very few choices after this. In a very reasonably scientific way, we can derive the whole code and being sure that it is correct. How? Let's look at this. So, of course, there's a standard transformation I showed you before. We will take this as the termination condition and maintain, make this the loop invariant. So now the strategy is simple. You have to find some x, y, start from any state, somehow keep changing x, y, provided you maintain this loop invariant. And then if you ever reach this condition, then your program will, you would have found the right value. So this from here to here would be a very standard transformation. Now the only reasonable value you can think of is x is 0 and y is n. Because anything else, if you are going to reduce the interval, you have ignored the part of the input, right? And that immediately gives us this precondition. If you are going to do x equal to 0, y equal to n, that means before we start this program, this condition must be true, right? So essentially, we have now separated our binary search problem in two parts. You can of course trivially check whether this condition is true or not. If it is false, then you can give a different answer. If the condition is true, then only you proceed with this piece of this code, right? So in that sense, in the correctness consideration show themselves off if we are being rigorous about the process. Okay. So given that we will maintain this invariant, now you have a strategy in mind, you are going to halve the interval, you are going to choose some point in the middle. And you know, one of the error in binary search is sometimes you don't get right in the middle, right? You may end up with if the two points are nearby, you just get in an infinite loop because you have not properly chosen. So right now, all we will say is choose a point in the middle that simply satisfies this condition. That is, the interval is getting narrower. That's all. That's the only requirement we'll put on this. And then we want to explore under what condition the left end of the interval will get reduced. Right? So x is assigned h. So very simple. All you have to do is to compute the vk. See, you want this predicate p to be true, the loop invariant p to be true after this assignment. So you compute the weakest precondition of this. What is the weakest precondition of p with respect to this? Well, you simply in p you substitute h for x, so you get this answer. So when you enter your loop body, p is true. After exiting from the loop body, reaching the end of the loop body, you want this to be true because you have not changed y, so ay greater than v stage. So you can do x is assigned h provided this is true. So you have calculated in some sense. So you have calculated this code fragment that if ah is less than or equal to v, you can safely do x is assigned h, and you know that the invariant will be maintained, that your program will be true. Similarly, you can ask when will I assign y to h, same thing, and then you find that okay, ax is unchanged. So y can be assigned to v if ah is greater than v, by the weakest precondition. So that immediately gives you, and it so happens these two conditions are complement of each other, making our life easy. So if ah is less than equal to v, x is assigned h, else ah is greater than v, y is assigned h. So look at the whole program. So we, in a way, we have finished writing the program. The program is correct. We have not yet decided what should be the value of h. The important point is, does not matter, as long as any value that satisfies this condition, the whole program is correct. So we could have chosen x, h as x plus 1 or y minus 1. It will be traditional linear search or something, but the whole program will be correct. So that is the important point, that we have identified what properties of the variables we are using. So the fact that we choose the midpoint as x plus y by 2 is only related to efficiency of this program, not related to the correctness of the program. Whereas in a traditional binary search, when you choose x plus y by 2 and the division is not proper, the program becomes incorrect. Okay? So look at this. This is a reasonably simple program, and I hope that never in your life will you get binary search wrong with this. If you just get this specification right, and this can be adapted for many different situations. Okay. So this is, and of course, this is a template. Remember, we have not even used the fact that array A is sorted. Nowhere did we need this in this derivation. The only property we needed was this. So from here we reach this, sortedness comes to assert that AX equal to V. If there was that one value that you wanted to find, it's only after this you will need the sortedness property. This piece of code does not need. And as a result of that, in fact, if you see, this is very similar to the bisection code for finding roots of a function, for example. So for those of you who are familiar, if you don't know, you can ignore it. But this code can simply be transplanted to find the roots of any function by finding two endpoints, one which is less than f of x, and one gives you f of x is greater than 0, f of x is less than 0. Keep taking the middle point and keep zoom in, and this condition will change till you reach within an epsilon threshold of that. So in that sense, this is what I meant by binary search can be adapted for many different situations. So that's my discussion of binary search. It's a simple example, and I thought all of you will be familiar. And now I will attempt something slightly more complicated. So if you have any question, feel free to interrupt at any point. Yes. In this piece of the code, yes. So the array sorted will be used if you want to know whether A of x equal to V or not. It is in this part that you will need the sortedness property. So you want to know the exact index. Otherwise, if the array was not sorted, then there will be many places where this condition could be true. X may give you multiple answer. Okay. Any other question? Okay. Yes.
So maybe you will address this later, but you are proposing this as something programmers must adopt, or is this a way to develop automated coding solutions? What is the bigger picture?
Right. So bigger picture here is this is about any problem. See, something like this you are doing informally in your head. When you start writing code, you have an informal coding strategy in your mind. What we want to make sure is that you can translate your ideas into a correct program. To that extent, you have a strategy, but you explore one step at a time. So what we did, you just remember what we did here. We introduced a loop. Then we said, I'm going to choose some point in the middle. I chose some x. And then I just said, okay, under what condition can the left point can be moved to that edge? So we explore logical consequences of the choices that you want to make. You have a vague idea that this series of choices will lead to my final answer. So here we want to make sure that you can do that rigorously. So in that sense, I am suggesting programmers adopt it to make sure that they can translate your ideas into correct code. Now, obviously, many of these ideas can also be used in automatic program synthesis, but that's not part of my research agenda. I mean, to the extent that it's all about program correctness, naturally automatic program synthesis has to deal with many of these issues. Okay. So now I come back to maximum segment sum problem. So we said to compute the maximum of all the segment sums of a given integer array. And this is just an example. Given this array, there are various segments, examples, and maximum of it is 6, which will come for this segment. So this is a reasonably famous problem. And a linear time algorithm was given in 1984. And many times I've tried this, and people typically write quadratic or even cubic solution. So what we'll see is that now you have some informal idea about how to get a linear time solution. And we will make sure that we can get that solution correctly. Just before that, to show that the problem is non-trivial, this is the book we use, Logic in Computer Science, our text. So sort of the almost similar problem, minimum segment sum, this is the code. The book tries to verify this problem, and while verifying, it's a two-page proof given. Somewhere it says, and I've just taken, this is the scan, this is the code. Essentially, it says that the something reveals the complexity and ingenuity of this program, and its justification needs to be taken offline. So it gives up on the formal proof and takes offline. The only point I want to make is that the book is saying this program is complex, it's ingenious, it's a very clever thing. The book is appreciating the writer of this program. Whereas our aim would be to argue that anybody, any one of us could have discovered this program if we were systematic, if we had the basic idea. So we would like to demystify how did someone come up with a program like this. Okay. So this is now the specification for the problem. So the we want max over, so all the PQ represent the endpoint of the segment, and this is the sum. Note that we have carefully allowed this definition allows empty segment, because P is less than equal to Q. So we allow, if all elements are negative, we allow empty segment to be an answer. If n can be 0, in which case the whole array is empty, and 0 is the maximum segment sum with an empty sum. So of course you can change the specification. But the point is, in correct by construction programming, lot of thought goes in coming up carefully with the specification. Lot of what we call are the bugs are actually errors of specification and not errors of implementation. When you say, oh, I didn't think of that case, it really means you were not thinking. Maybe you thought P could must be strictly less than Q. You unconsciously, you just assume that in some part of the code. Okay. So this separation is important of errors of specification and implementation. So now I have already shown. So this is the post condition. The first step is, now we know that same thing, we want to iterate the array from left to right, and so we want to this transformation I talked about. Note that this is a semantic step. Essentially, this is a strategy you have in mind, and this is a simple syntactic implementation of the strategy. So the fact that you happens to replace capital N with small n is incidental. For some other problem, you would have done something different maybe. Okay. So we rewrite this as this, and the termination condition, of course, we know that n has to be n. This P1 we have introduced for basically making sure the loop will terminate. So I will just retain the P1, but not talk about this. It's only important for a termination argument that I'm not going to cover today in the talk. So in general, it's a good idea that whenever you introduce a variable, you introduce bounds for it. And then you, during the program, if your variable is going to go out of those bounds, then your calculation will suggest that. Okay. So with this, we get this simple program that while n not equal to n and P0 and P1 are your invariant. This variant is again required for loop termination. Essentially, every iteration of the loop, this quantity must reduce. And when this quantity becomes 0, then the loop is going to terminate. So we will not discuss the variant or beyond this. This is the very first thing, very reasonable and straightforward. And now question is again how to construct loop body. Of course, I have already told you before that the only thing we can guess is we are moving from left to right. So n has to become n plus 1 at some point in time. Okay. So now, what must be true before this? Well, this P0, which is what is the loop invariant, we compute the weakest precondition of P0, and which is nothing but in P0, n is replaced with n plus 1. So we have an unknown program S1, whose precondition is P0, whose post condition is P0, n replaced with n plus 1. And our task is to construct S1. And we know if S1 can be constructed with P0, S1, P0, and n plus 1, then whole program is correct by construction. Now, how do we go about constructing S1? What is the guiding criteria? What should go in the body of S1? Well, you compare its pre and post condition. Pre condition is P0, post condition is P0, n is assigned n plus 1. So let's look at P0 here. In the post condition, we replace n with n plus 1. P and Q are dummy. Right? So therefore, in some sense, R must change. If you are changing the right hand side, R has to potentially change for this equality to hold. So therefore, R must have some new value R prime. So, and the point I am emphasizing here is that in correct by construction programming, there is always a justification for attempting something. Of course, sometimes you can't think of a justification, you may make a blind guess also. But so far, we have not made any blind guesses. We have always argued why we need to do something. So, R is assigned R prime, where R prime is some new value of R that we don't know. But this S1, the unknown program, remember its precondition is P0, post condition is this. So R prime must be such that this is satisfied. So by now we can guess that what we really want to do is to compute the weakest precondition. Remember, what was weakest precondition? What must be true at this point such that doing this assignment will result in this? That is the weakest precondition. The necessary condition so that executing this will result in this state. And the necessary condition is, of course, straightforward. Further, we make a second substitution in this. In place of R, we put R prime, right? So in P0, put N plus 1 in place of N, put R prime in place of R. Is that okay? Please ask me, because this is really the fundamental step. In some sense, there is not much to program correctness when you think about it. It's with the pointer-free program. So the assignment is the only thing that changes state, and you have to relate the state before the assignment to state after the assignment. And the other thing is the loop termination, the loop invariant. So there are very few concepts, actually, if you think about any program. So let's look at this now in more detail. We simply substitute P0 definition. Okay. And now this WP is nothing but these replacements. So all we have gotten here is now R prime equal to this. Everybody with me? This is what we want. This we want to find the R prime, so which will be equal to this expression. You had done certain iterations of the loop, and R was holding the partial result, the partial max seen so far. You have done one more iteration of the loop, and you want to know what is the new max. That's all. So that's the insight. Now the goal is, of course, in a programming is to relate the new iteration of the loop to everything done so far. It's like the inductive step in an inductive proof. You have something, and now you have done some little extra work, and you would like to relate the two. So you essentially would like to rewrite this expression such that you can bring in the R, whose value you already knew so far. So remember, because this is the N plus first step you are talking about, the simplest strategy is to really try to talk about work done till the nth step and the work done in the N plus first step. And so you look at this predicate, Q less than equal to N plus 1. It's nothing but either Q is less than equal to N or Q equal to N plus 1. So from standard rules of logic, you can rewrite this range as this. Okay. So this is the from the rules of logic. And now, the next rule tells you can split the range when the operator is the max. So all you are saying is R prime is either the max till the nth iteration or the max of this expression. Okay. So this is the extra value that got computed in the n, or needs to be computed in the n plus first iteration. The point is, this logical manipulation are telling us what needs to be done in the n plus first iteration or in any iteration of the loop. So this is where the correct by construction is coming up, that our program will be correct by construction if R prime has this value. Of course, we know this expression. These are logic expressions. They are not program variables. Finally, our program, we need to replace them with program variable. So we already know that P0 means that this expression is nothing but R. Okay. So we'll get this. We can replace this expression with R. And now we get R max something. And we can simplify it further because Q equal to N plus 1. So Q was a dummy, but whose value we know? It's N plus 1. We can replace Q with N plus 1. Okay. So we get this expression. Okay. So this is the really the main heart of the construction. That when you say the clever, how did one thinks about this? So the logical formula, essentially this formula, right? You said after N plus first iteration, you would like this. And this is all guided. You can ask, why did I do range split? Why did I do this? Because pretty much those were the only, sort of the standard things to do in that. You think about you are doing the N plus first iteration, you want to relate nth iteration to the next thing. So these are all not wild guesses, they are guess in some sense. This may or may not have worked, but these are all educated guesses. Okay, in that sense, why we are calling it an art? Because which rule to apply at which point would be an art? Science is, it tells you that if I apply this rule, how should the resulting expression will look like? That is the science. So now, the only issue is that this is again a logic expression, but we need some program variable. So at this point, we have a choice. We can either compute this, we can write a loop of where P will go from 0 to N plus 1, and we can compute this expression. But we are exploring whether we can derive a linear solution or not. Okay. So to do that, essentially we introduce another variable S, which is equal to this expression. There is some technicality here, but essentially remember here we have N, here we have N plus 1. So we have to assume P2 N is assigned N plus 1. If we assume that is at this point in the code, that is where r prime is given this assignment, if this is true, then r prime is this. Okay. So we have now filled up one more hole. Remember, this whole thing was a hole. Now we have come up, we have discovered this program fragment r max s. While discovering this, we introduce a new invariant p2, that s, a new variable we introduce, and that variable holds this value. And now, of course, our job is to make sure that p2 is true before this. Also, we chose to propose p2 as a loop invariant. So, assuming p2 was true here, we have to come here, and then we have to make sure that at the end of the loop p2 will be true, which it turns out. If you just push this p2 through here, because n was n plus 1, p2 will become true at the end. So, we are that was a separate check that needs to be done. It happens to be true when we have proposed this as a loop invariant. Okay. Now we can do this. So essentially, this S1, like I said, this is an independent subproblem. R does not occur here. So this is like a new problem to be solved. So you can apply the same strategy, and then you can calculate S. It turns out S is slightly more complicated expression. But this is mainly because the n plus 1 occurs in two places. This complication comes because the range split here gets rid of this n plus 1, but it does not get rid of that n plus 1. So that brings in the complication, but again in some 7-8 steps you can, by straightforward calculation, I mean when I say complication meaning you have to be careful, you can't, if you are careless you will make an error. If you do it carefully you will discover this. So this is our final program, and I submit that any one of us who have studied the technique could have discovered this program. There is nothing complex, nothing magical about this program. This gives you a linear time program for maximum segment sum. Of course, it's possible that we may not have been able to complete this program. Maybe we chose a path where maybe there is another problem for which there is no linear time solution. In that case, we would not have reached till this point. Okay. So please see if you have any question, because this finishes the derivation of the maximum segment sum. Yes. Yes.
Suppose over these heuristics and get a program, right? What stops you from automating this?
Good question. Anybody wants to answer that? Of course, for
finally, because we know this solution, how do you even know this set of heuristics? Because one has tried it. So as one solves more and more problem, one can keep increasing the databases of the heuristic, and a brute force over that will naturally always give. But for example, I will tell you, I said there is a technicality. As of now, this, remember what we could have done, we could have simply introduced this as an invariant, S equal to this expression. We did not do that. Okay. So S equal to this expression would have been a natural choice to make. Actually, that leads to an out of bound error, array out of bound error. I told you at some places there is a technicality. So this is again in that sense a creative step to actually not use n plus 1, but to use this. That is one answer. So for this particular, similarly there are other choices we made. For example, what if there was no linear solution to this problem? So the program that you are saying, the computer, right? So we would have to, maybe we have to introduce a loop here to compute this expression. I mean, instead of sum, suppose we are computing some other predicate, then somewhere you have to use the property of that predicate. So which property of the predicate to use? So obviously, for, as I said, as your database increases more and more, and in a brute force method, you can try many things, many problems will be solved. Thankfully, as of now, that, I mean, the programming is not a solved task. So we are in business still. I don't know if I answered your question, but I'm saying yes. Once you have solved something, you put that in database, and if those steps are going to be tried in some combination, then eventually you will discover some of the solution. Question is, how effective is it on every new problem you have? To the extent that it's a science, and to the extent I have been arguing that there are very few choices, so well-defined heuristic may lead to a lot of good program. So I agreed that a lot of these ideas will be useful for automatic program synthesis also, but it's just that we are not there yet.
Heuristics is large enough, too large to be discovered. So, wouldn't a bigger challenge be to come up with heuristics automatically because solving this is a, I mean, it's kind of cheating, right? Because you know what are the at right places, you know what are the right things to do in order to arrive at the solution.
So if you are saying that I knew the solution
and therefore I could derive it, then that's not. So first, so I will show you now a few examples where I did not know the solution. That solution I had never seen in my life before. I applied the technique and I got that solution. In fact, there were other known solutions for the problem. So that is the one part. Other part is, in our business, it's good to have the huge challenges. So you can do a PhD and, I mean, in a serious way, come up with some set of heuristics. In fact, in the process, we have come up with some set of heuristics. We have systematized some of the knowledge of what heuristic to apply under what situation. So to that extent, of course, that yes, it's a huge challenge and we need a lot more people to attempt this challenge. But let me just show you some more example. Okay, so before moving to examples, point I want to say is that on one end it's huge, but a lot of problem, at least to understand this concept, there is a small set of core concepts. So of course you have to understand first order logic, this is specification, the loop invariant I talked about, and these assertions I put in the middle. They are called annotations because they are static thing. Assertion typically used as a runtime assertion when you know the value of the variable. But the annotation is true regardless of the value of the variable. And then I discuss some of these rules that we applied. So using this small set of rules, a lot of problem can be solved. Point is, that's what we are doing, at least in the initial courses, when we are learning programming, when we are thinking about correctness. Then these concepts are enough, because most of them, see, what makes a program hard is a loop. Otherwise, of course, program, you can't go very far without a loop. Then it will be a linear flow. In a loop, essentially, you have to think about the next iteration of the loop, how it relates to the work done so far. So that's why some of these rules suffice. When I'm saying there's a small core that you can master to solve many problems, of course, you will run into complicated situation where this won't suffice. You will have to transform your formula in a different way. You have to think of the new properties of the function being computed. So that's where the creative step comes in. Okay? So the methodology, in some sense, again, answering your question was, whenever possible, you would like to follow this outer path. So this is to the extent that mechanically it's possible, some natural predicate transformation will suggest themselves. If they don't, then you have to think of the properties. What property of sum you should exploit? We have implicitly exploited many properties, that the sum is a symmetric associative operator. I mean, I didn't talk about this because it's so obvious that we implicitly exploited that. If it was not so, then maybe this schema would not have worked, right? And finally, even you can't find you can't calculate it, but maybe you want to try something. So you would like to guess something and then locally verify that whether this works or not, whether this maintains the invariant or not. So this is roughly the programming methodology we are proposing. Just to give you an example, I will not go through the details of the derivation, but I will just show. It's a very simple problem. Just read the statement. In fact, you would think it's so simple that it should not be talked about. Given an array, write a program to compute if there exists a sequence of 50 true entry followed by 50 false entry. Of course, the idea is every time you don't want to read last 100 entry. You want to make sort of a single pass algorithm and doing only maybe few variable lookups, not 100, because this 50 could have been 500 or 5000, right? This is a very simple problem. So sort of so now the specification gets slightly complicated. It says there exists a point such, and so instead of 50, we use the D, the range, such that M minus 2D to M minus D. So you have D values that are true and followed by D values that are false. That is the specification for this. So I will just, so far is the standard thing that we did before. We try n not equal to n and then all. At this point, the calculations get a bit complicated. So you try to compute the new value of R, and then you will find that something else gets introduced. And this time we don't make it a loop invariant. So actually we again introduce a new variable S, but this P3 need not be loop invariant. In fact, we materialize it right here without introducing a loop invariant using some further calculations, and then further invariants are needed. So we again go into another program. Finally, that S2 we calculate, and again, it's a similar loop, and you find S2 is this. So look at this final program. So this is the final program. Of course, this is a lot of assertion, but now compare it to some standard solution. This is an alternative solution. Both are correct, and both have similar complexity. But I mean, just to answer the question, that at this point, it's not that I had seen the solution before. This is the solution I came up with, I've never seen it in my life before, and it's dramatically different from the known solution, or which also I had not seen. I saw this only after I came up with this. Okay, so that hopefully that answers. I mean, this was a standard. This question came in CS 101, one of the tests. So this was the model solution for the. Okay, this is essentially a state machine approach. So this approach also you can do a correct by construction of. But it's the what strategy you choose. I chose a different strategy here. I may have decided that I will employ a state machine, and then I can do a correct by construction derivation of this solution. In that sense, I mean the methodology helps you implement your ideas correctly. Which idea, which path to follow is an art, right? That was a choice we had to make. This is a framework for organizing your thought for exploring logical consequences of your idea. So what you were doing informally earlier, now you are doing formally, and you have an early discovery of an error. Or sometimes you may have no clue what to do. And here, for example, that S expression, particularly the way we got S plus this thing. Yeah, if you made an error in that calculation, then yes. But the point is, detecting errors in calculation is an easier task than detecting error in a program. So I give you a program and I didn't put that max zero part. You read it, somebody else reads it, and they have to figure out whether this program works or not. Either they will think about it or they will test and they will discover. So in that sense, it's clearly the methodology is helping you, because that calculation you can recheck, somebody else can recheck, and then you will discover errors much earlier. So A, checking error, but not B, just suggesting itself. Because some of these invariants are not obvious. Once you learn the technique, so then the invariants suggest themselves. Part of it I have been emphasizing that if you are systematic, there are very few things to be done. A good student need not know logic, they will be systematic in their mind, they can see it. Most of us, probably the methodology will help. Okay. So just one more example, because this question has been asked. Okay, so this is, maybe I will skip this example. Essentially here again you see this, just this, what you have to compute is p equal to a to the power b. Of course you can multiply a b times, but you would like to speed it up, somewhere you would like to use the power. So trick is to come up with this specification. So that is again something you can say, you can templatize it, but there are lot of ways in which you can do it. In fact, it will lead to lot of different solutions. So rest of it I will not go into, but I mean it's essentially, once you decide on this as an invariant, then again it gives you the same thing, and then you explore what if I introduce a power of x, you can calculate the consequences of that, you can come up with the right answer. But I will tell you another problem. Again, this is a problem published in Science of Computer Programming, called MBOX. Let's not worry about the problem. Just to show that, again, I had not seen the solution. This is a two different separate routines with lot of nested loops. This was the published solution. This is a solution that when we solved it using the methodology, I mean, following one particular approach, we got this solution. That's as different from this as it can be. These are two pre-processing routine, the L-fill and R-fill, and this is the final code, which is fundamentally different from what we did here without any pre-processing. So anyway, so that's the part of it. So this is just some motivational example. What is the research agenda here? I'm sure many of you want to know. So essentially what I talked about, this calculational style of correct by construction programming, and we said it helps in constructions and more opportunity to explore alternative solution. But as we discussed, the one of the problem is this manual. What if you made an error like it was asked? So you would like a sense of certainty. If you are giving me a scientific method, I would like to know my answer is correct. I can recheck it, but if it will be nice to have more than that. And some degree of drudgery is involved, because a lot of obvious things that you can see through also have to be formally proved. So this is the work. This system has been built by my PhD student Deepak, who is here. And the goal was to automate the mundane task and leave the creative task for the user, provide a framework. Okay. So essentially, I will just, since we don't have much time, I will quickly just run through this. So that previous derivation that we had, I showed you this derivation. If it was to be done in a tool, then you would need to organize it. Essentially, you have to think about the what are the programs, and here we are just doing pure formula manipulation. So you have to switch between program mode and formula mode. And then you have these tactics to apply, which will apply to do this transformation, then you step into something, go back out, and then you sometimes this may not work out. So you may have to backtrack, take a different branch, and so on. So this is what the tool looks like. Essentially, there is a content panel. On the side, you can choose which tactic to apply, And for the chosen tactic, you can apply the parameters. The important point about the tool is that it's not a text edit, it's not a program, it's not a text flow here. This is a hierarchical system. So after a lot of experimentation and thought, we have decided to use this hierarchical system where the direct editing is not allowed. But you are saying the program has to be correct by construction at all point. If you are arbitrarily change one part of the program, then obviously your whole program will break down. So you are only allowed to change the program by applying a tactic, and system will check if the tactic application is valid or not, and system will reject your tactic application if it's not valid. And with each sub program, there are associated pre and the post condition, and of course there are unknown program fragments which also have the associated pre and the post condition. So your whole program is in some sense a tree, the hierarchical tree. Then of course there are a lot of program transformation techniques like this we saw many times. The important point here is that there are certain applicability conditions that this program can be translated into this provided P implies R1. So the system integrates with a theorem prover to verify this. Okay, that and otherwise it will say sorry, P does not imply R1 and therefore this transformation will be rejected. Then you have to step into sub formula, a lot of formula manipulation facilities provided here. And then of course you have to extract the context properly, and so there are a lot of interesting research work to be done here. And then of course sometime you want, like we said, you don't want to go through the detailed formal thing, so you may just want to guess the thing without doing the detailed calculus. You say, oh, I know x equal to 0 will do the task. So then you are allowed it, system can verify it, and then if it can, of course the verification may fail even though your guess is correct. The verification, because system is not powerful enough, right? Not all theorems can be verified automatically. So similarly, the formula manipulation can be verified, and so this is the. There are a lot of other things in the system, like you can shut off some of the annotations, so you can go to into minimal view. You can capture the derivation history, where did you branch, what are the different tactics you applied, and all of that. So that is all about the GUI. Of course, then there is lot of research has gone into the theoretical foundations of the system, what kind of transformation rules are to be up, how do you extract a context, and then sometimes there is a formula manipulation rule changes, then there are other things like assumption propagation, when you are doing manually, we are making lot of jumps, when you try to formalize it, lot of challenges come up, right, that as you introduce as a new variable, where is that variable supposed to be declared? How is that variable, when we say, okay, it is going to be part of a loop invariant, how do we propagate it? So this is a theory of assumption propagation that we have come up with. Anyway, we can ignore this. These are this whole set of program transformation rule. These are the four publications that are available from my web page and the CAPS web page. The theoretical foundations are described here, and then the IDE design teaching experience and so on. Okay. So, thank you.